Don't hate me for this. I've only just started reading for the first time, 1984.
Oh,
No,
wow.
I thought you were going to say you just started reading the Communist Manifesto or something, but I'm Oh, I've
sure I
read
made
that.
you
No,
read
I've
that in
read
class
that.
at
No,
one point.
yeah, that's right.
Any
I
We all know Cormac's a big lefty, so
have
putting it
noticed
out there.
that, yeah.
Yeah. Welcome to another episode of This Catholic Life, conversations about life's ups and downs, big and small, how we deal with every situation imaginable, whatever life throws at us, but still manage to be sensible, practical, and joyful. Today's show is virtual worlds, in a world where technology allows us to see and experience things we could not in real life. What are we getting out of virtual reality, and what are we missing in virtual reality? What are the implications morally and psychologically and all the other ways? I'm your host, Peter Holmes, and today I'm joined by Renee Kohler-Ryan, Professor in Philosophy at the University of Notre Dame.
Hello, Peter.
Hello, Renee. And Cormac McCann, another co-host, the usual rabble-rouser and, as we've just established, lefty. No, sorry, just joking. Welcome, Cormac.
Thanks, as always,
if
Peter,
anything,
for having
you would
me.
Be centre-left. You wouldn't be, you know, left-left, right, Cormac? Is that the way it goes?
Oh, I'm just not going to...
You're not just going to fight.
He's not going to dignify that with a response. Yes.
We already established in a couple of episodes ago that left and right are pretty much meaningless these days anyway, so it's more of a fun jibe than anything serious. Before we get started, just a reminder, if you like the show, you should subscribe on your podcast app, and that way you won't miss an episode. Also, if you haven't done so already, drop us a review in iTunes. It helps other people come to know that we're around. So let's get started. I'm going to do a little bit of talking at the start because these two have
admitted. Surprise,
yes. Well, you two have both admitted that virtual reality is not your forte. You're not really into the whole VR scene. And
I like
and
the real world too much.
Yeah. Virtual high five, Renee.
Yay.
There's an irony, giving a virtual high five
it was
over
total
liking the real
distancing.
World more than virtual reality. So more to the point, there's an old saying from people who play a lot of online games. They say, yeah, I've tried reality. The graphics are great, but the gameplay sucks. So the
what impoverished imaginations these people have.
What's interesting about virtual reality is that often when it very closely mirrors reality, people don't like it. It's too drab. It's too boring. Whereas when you play the more successful online games, they tend to be really heavy on primary colors and glowy things, and you know there's a kind of a more real than real feel to it. Virtual reality, though, is more than just for computer games. I could go on and on, as you no doubt people have heard me do, about virtual reality. But it's not just about computer games. We'll come back to the morality of some computer games in a minute, but it's also used for training airline pilots, medical specialists, specialist forces, anti-terrorism, police forces. Even driving tests in some places are done, some parts of driving tests are done through virtual reality. And you can actually get a sense of the skills and, you know, quite dangerous situations can be replicated in virtual reality. One other factor is that in medical situations, they can help deal with phobias and even diagnose and treat some forms of schizophrenia by creating virtual worlds which respond to and help, you know, give gentle introduction to those circumstances. So virtual reality has a very strong track record already in its early inception for helping us out. The questions we have to ask are, what are the issues involved in presenting yourself online or going into a not quite real place online? So I want to just put out there that this is big business. It's not just us playing around with computers or something. It's huge business. So, for example, a couple of issues ago, Cormac raised the movie Avatar as an example of this amazing other world we might sink into.
I think that was me, actually, Peter.
You're right, Renee.
You don't necessarily want to blame Cormac for bringing that one up. I'm quite happy to take the blame for that one.
Yeah, thanks for that.
No worries.
Well, I'm just using it as an example because Avatar took about 15 years from initial conception to release, and it grossed about nearly $3 billion. World of Warcraft is a game, which is a virtual reality game, not in the proper sense of virtual reality, but it's an online world. It took about 4 years to build, and it's been taking subscriptions since 2004, and currently it's at about between 18 and $20 billion worth of revenue. So we're talking about 10 times the amount of money involved in the, you know, one of the top movies as is in the, you know, top games sort of thing. So where there's money, there's going to be other issues. Another factor is that in some online worlds, things get really serious. So in a game called EVE Online, there was a battle called the Battle of BR5RB. It was a 21-hour battle in which massive number of players were involved, but basically about $300,000 worth of virtual materials were destroyed in that battle. And that actually meant $300,000 of real money went down the tube in one online virtual battle. That's an obscene amount of sort of investment. In another online game, which hadn't even been released yet, someone bought a meteorite in the game. They bought real estate and then they resold it off. And they bought it for something like $10,000 and resold it for more in a few days. So they actually, there's investments going on. My question is, what happens if one of these deals goes wrong? You know, what's the morality involved in it? It's just pixels. What if a real estate deal ended up, someone got ripped off or something? There's no legal framework to deal with this sort of thing. But also, what about acts in virtual reality? In one of the games, someone posed as a bank and ripped off a whole bunch of other players to the tune of $100,000, just took money off them pretending to be a bank and then ran away with it.
Just to interject here, Peter, when you're talking about $10,000, people aren't trading real life currency of their own savings or whatever, are they?
Virtual money in these games has a real value. So there's a real value in real life. You can purchase, for example, a certain amount of currency in the game with a certain amount of real currency, and there's an exchange rate, right? So it's not Bitcoin. It's a kind of basically in World of Warcraft, you're not supposed to buy it with real money, but people do on the black market. But something like EVE, you literally purchase currency in the game, and so you can price items in the game by how much it would cost you to buy that item.
And so games have things like your credit card details or whatever that you use, whatever it is.
Yes.
And what are the kind of rates that we're looking at? Is it kind of $1 to 10 virtual US dollars? Like what are we talking about here?
It changes immensely. So this is the reason I keep using US dollars as a amount, because you know in Second Life, the game, you talk about lindens. In EVE, you talk about credits, all of these things. And those currencies fluctuate. So in World of Warcraft, it used to be that, say, one gold would cost you, you know, 10 US dollars or something like that. But that's become much less now that the game's gone on. The currency's been devalued. But the point is that there's real money in it. There's people have actually spent money to get in there, or they've invested a huge amount of their personal time and effort to get that value within the game, which they could conceivably sell and get money back for outside of the game. I know people who actually, they're full-time creating things in Second Life, the game, and selling them within the game, and they can pay their rent that way. So their productivity is actually in a virtual world.
What are the implications of playing these kind of games online and investing actual tangible assets? I mean, you're always investing, obviously, your time and whatever it costs to acquire the game initially. But I want to basically throw out there, is it the same? Are we talking about something that is of equal moral relevance and consequence as losing assets in a game or ripping someone off in a game versus doing that in the real world? Being a bad landlord or ripping somebody off? Because I kind of think that's where we should probably angle towards.
Let's test that out a little bit, and I'll ask Renee's help here. This is the kind of thing I'm getting towards. In scenario A, I convince Cormac that I own the Sydney Harbour Bridge and I sell it to him, and then I run away with the money. And then in scenario B, I convince Cormac that I own a meteorite or a plot of land in a virtual reality, and he pays me the money and I run away with the money.
This story doesn't go well for me.
No, no. You need to re-examine your life choices there, Cormac.
So I am asking Cormac, what's the moral difference between these two? Isn't the same deception involved and monetary gain involved with using illicit means?
Cormac, well, my response to that, Peter, is to play the Dean of Philosophy card from Notre Dame. Boom, Renee, take it away.
Well, I'd sort of like to go in a completely different direction altogether, because there's a wonderful and maybe then I could come back to what you're asking, Peter, but there's a really good, I usually don't like these things, but thought experiment. And the thought experiment goes like this. Suppose I've got two choices. My first choice is that I can train for the Olympics and I will put everything I've got into getting into the Olympics. And if I make it, great. And then if I win a medal, even better. But, you know, I'm going to give it everything that I've got. Well, why not just go into some kind of virtual reality where I will have all of the experience of winning at the Olympics, but not necessarily all of the experience of the pain and the hardship and the not knowing if I'm going to make it and all of the anxiety that goes along with that. Which one of these two would I choose? And the philosopher who put this experiment together made the claim that it's far better to go through the real world experience rather than the virtual reality experience, because that tells you something about yourself genuinely in relationship to the real world in a way that virtual reality never can. And it's also a way of looking at benefits, and I think that ultimately it's a way of looking at pleasure or happiness. So what does real happiness, where does real happiness reside? And the thought is, or the thinking behind this is, that life itself has ups and downs, and you could never have that moment of absolute triumph, of absolutely feeling that you had won at the Olympics and it was amazing, if you hadn't gone through the real hardship of trying to get there in the first place. So there's no kind of, you know, influx of just some kind of pleasurable activity without that is uniquely the pleasure of winning that Olympic medal when you've worked so hard for it, or, you know, there's this great Australian movie that's been out there called Ride Like a Girl, with winning the Melbourne Cup, when you watch the jockey go through all of this with her family and trying to, you know, and when she finally wins the race, you're like, yeah, you knew she was going to win all along, but yes, this is fantastic.
It's such a good
My
film,
husband
actually.
Still doesn't understand why I watch it, because you know what's going to happen at the end, but that's all right. So I think that virtual reality for me really raises issues like that. So money changing hands, I mean, people can defraud each other and enter into all sorts of questionable monetary arrangements in the real world and in the virtual world. And to me, the morality of the situation doesn't really change based on where that's happening, because people do stupid things with money. I've never had enough of a budget to do anything radically stupid, but people buy things that are unnecessary. They buy things just to have the pleasure of feeling that they've bought them. So people have in the real world bought meteorites and, you know, weird things like that as well. So for me, the moral difference there isn't that it's not different.
Okay. Can I come back to one of the points you raised there about your assumption in that analogy is that virtual reality would only simulate an achievement rather than actually be an achievement. So some gamers and even online virtual reality people would say it is an achievement, for example. I'm not simulating fighting a dragon in the real world because there's no dragons, but in the real world I don't have the same kind of fights, but in an online game way back when I had time to play them, sometimes you'd spend months working on the skills involved and the equipment and all of the necessary things involved to get to a certain level and to achieve a certain goal. And then when you got there, it actually was a feeling of achievement. You had to coordinate up to 40 people in teamwork and get them to coordinate perfectly online and have almost like a military-like discipline. And that achievement is an achievement which could be replicated in real life if you played a team sport or something like that, but it's achievement in itself. It's not replicating, like, it's not like putting on FIFA, you know, on your Xbox or whatever it is on your PlayStation and just pressing the button and suddenly you are the world's best player and you have the perfect skills to hit that crossbow or whatever it is. It's not like that. It's actually, you have to actually start from scratch and build up. So they would suggest that these achievements require that level of blood, sweat, and tears However, the question I have still is, if you have beaten the dragon in the virtual reality, no matter how much skill it took, no matter how much effort it took or how much money it took, is it the same morally as, for example, building something in the local park, you know, or you know, having an actual achievement? I think this is what Cormac was getting at. Is it useful? Does it pay the rent? You know,
well, that's
does it do anything?
It's not even that it pays the rent, Peter. I actually think I'd like to take just a fraction back before you ask that final question. And, you know, we can talk about what is the moral relevance or value of something. There are multiple moral frameworks and, you know, utilitarianism or consequentialism being another one of them. And you say, well, we could ask, well, what's the utility of someone playing, you know, a game and coordinating with up to 40 people that takes several months? We'd probably say that, you know, we could talk about the opportunity cost of your time and effort and energy invested in, maybe you're coordinating a complex, you know, military operation that's going to take several months. You're trying to take, you know, Hacksaw Ridge or something like that. And you can say, well, that's an achievement at the end of the day. But actually, I'm prepared to concede that it would be an achievement of coordinating people sitting at your desk behind a computer screen and all of the skills involved in that aspect of management. But I would say that it bears absolutely categorically in no way any relationship to actual the physical conquering of ground or in any way going through the real life motion of actually taking the ridge, going through the absolute terrifying scenario of bullets flying over your head, of having to dive into a trench to escape death, to drag your comrades. Well, comrades is, sorry, is really the wrong word. Your compatriots.
It's your communist roots coming out again.
That's right. Here we go.
I say at the start, I'm reading 1984 at the moment, and that's why
it's creeping into your language.
It's creeping into my language already. I'm guilty of thought crime, speak crime, all of it.
Wow.
I just think that, we can talk about the only way you can talk about, I think, an achievement in the virtual world is whatever skill set it gives you in the real world, if that makes sense. Mm. So the skills involved, you want to upskill your requirement, like your equipment or whatever. Well, that might mean that you know how to conduct a negotiation online to obtain weapons, but it's in no way going to be able to be translated, I think, into, you know, you're not going to, we get invaded by a foreign power, then we're looking for volunteers to go and coordinate military strategy. And Peter puts up his hand and says, well, actually, I've conducted complex military operations online. I've got extensive experience in this. You can actually hire me.
This has actually happened. The army recruited out of, like, they had one particular combat game which was very complex and very realistic, and the army actually took some of the best players in America and offered them, you know, entry into their programs, because they'd shown that they had the awareness and targeting skills and all those sorts of things, and they basically had to just check if they were physically capable of it.
Not just check if someone's physically capable. I mean, that's the linchpin, isn't it? Like, it's a just check if you're a person, if you can get married, you know. It's like, it's just this little small detail.
Is it also like a small detail, and that could be that there is a way in which a gamer can distance themselves from what's actually happening? That's what would concern me more. If you know you're in a game and you're used to doing things in a game, then I think in a military situation, they do want to, in some ways, desensitize people to what's going on. So if the person who's going from the gaming world into an actual military situation can be made to think, oh, well, it's just like when I was in the game world, then you're going to have a far greater chance of getting them to do what you want them to do and what needs to be done. And that's what I would find a bit more scary.
Particularly, Renee, if you're employing people to fly drones and things like
that. Exactly.
So it's almost like a computer game in some respects. Having said that, there has been some research. There's been a lot of attempts to prove that computer games and virtual reality cause violence, but they've not proven that. What they have demonstrated is that it desensitizes people to certain scenarios, which is exactly what you were saying, Renee.
Yeah.
So that, for example, one experiment had a bunch of just early teens, kids in their early teens, and one group, the control group, played racing car games or whatever, just something a bit harmless.
Except if you put them in a car and put them on the road, I would suggest, but okay.
That's another experiment I should talk about. But basically,
picking flowers, a game picking flowers.
I like the whole fighting dragons things. I find dragons everywhere.
Yeah. So the other side of it, though, The other side of it was a violent first-person shooter. So they were literally shooting people and seeing blood and guts and everything in the first person. Now, when they told the kids they were going to do a questionnaire afterwards, but what happened was that the interviewer came into the room and simulated an accident. So she fell over and all her gear spilled all over the floor and she hurt herself, right? So then what the test was is how the kids then reacted to the accident. And so what the interesting result was is that 8 out of 10 of the kids who hadn't played the violent game, so they played the racing car games, 8 out of 10 of the kids jumped up, showed empathy, reacted, tried to help. Whereas 8 out of 10 of the kids who had played the violent games didn't react. They just were indifferent, like they simply just didn't react to the other person's small disaster. So it was pretty much an indication that desensitization is a real thing. I mean, this is after 4 hours of playing, and some of these kids are playing for, you know, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of hours of this stuff. First-person shooters are kind of the first step into virtual reality. When I went to a gaming convention a couple of years ago, it's now 4 or 5 years ago, put on a VR headset, one of the very first realistic games, and watched a human person, simulation of a human person walk past, and it was extremely difficult to spot whether it was you were in a real situation or not. I thought someone had gotten into the space that I was doing my virtual reality in. Now, my first thought was this could actually lead to a whole range of moral problems in the treatment of human beings. And then I walked around the corner to the first game they had on offer, and it was basically a game where you took chainsaws to zombies. So in virtual reality. So I thought, yep, well, we're there already. The whole idea of just virtual reality being used to portray a situation which is abhorrent and encourages kind of horrible mistreatment of human bodies, and yet claiming that it's not a moral problem because it's in virtual reality.
Yeah, I think that it might be interesting to have a look at this question in relationship to a question that's often asked about art. So art and also play. Cormac was pointing out earlier that looking at gaming only through a kind of utilitarian or consequentialist lens, where you're just saying, well, where am I getting bang for my buck here, is not really the only approach that could be used. So you could be asking something different, which would be, am I doing an action? Is this a human action which may not be for some kind of gain in that utilitarian sense, but it could be something that's good in itself. So it's actually something that's nurturing to me as a human person. So I would say that philosophical activity doesn't really make that much of a difference in terms of monetary gain, or, you know, the arts are really under attack right now because of financial constraints and budgetary constraints. And people might say, yeah, but I mean, it's not like they bring that much of an income or resources into the world or anything like that. But I think we all know that when those are lacking from the world, something is really lacking. So I would say the same of art. I'd say the same of sport even. And I'm not the most sporty person around by any means, but I just to see the delight on a neighbor's face the other day when from a distance he said, it looks like we'll get the NRL back in May. I thought, good on you, mate. I'm very glad. You know, I've been thinking, oh, well, you know, so NRL isn't playing, big deal. But actually it is a big deal, and something is missing if it's not there. So my question would be, if gaming were not in society, would we be missing something or not?
I think we would, but that's a bias as someone who's got a lot of not just pleasure but community out of gaming. So a lot of when I got married, I wasn't able to go and play. I used to play a lot of team sports, so I played with lots of other guys of roughly my age and some mixed teams as well. So really strong community. But when I got married, it wasn't possible to be out doing all the training and doing all the extra stuff, and I simply found that community that I could online game with friends regularly, say on the weekends, without necessarily having to leave the house and be with, you know, be away from my wife and the kids, etc. And it meant that in a desperate situation, I could just drop everything and help out in the family. So if someone, you know,
I know you say desperate, it had to be desperate, huh?
Well, admittedly, the situation had to be very carefully controlled because, of course, my focus was very much distracted, and we had to negotiate how many hours this was, you know, just like sports, you negotiate how many hours. And one of the dangers of computers is that they keep sucking your hours away. And people who've become addicted to online gaming, and yes, it is possible, tend to do so because they don't keep control of their own actions. Can I throw just another sort of moral angle? It's not that it's a bit of a twist on what we've already talked about. Lots of people talk about, there's no problem with people playing violent computer games. Now, stylized violence is something that's been part of games for a long time. In fact, many sports are actually just a kind of formalized warfare, kind of, you know, put within rules so that we can test strength against each other. Even chess is a kind of a virtual war in a kind of a kingdom setting. But the whole concept of someone's, you know, cutting human bodies up and you know, shooting them all day doesn't seem to bother us. However, this is a question I put to my classes when they say there's no problem with virtual games, there's no problem with it. I say, all right, I'm aware of at least three games that have been refused classification and entry into Australia because they involved sexually predatory behavior of minors and torture scenes. Now, in those cases, our regulatory bodies have rightly said this is not appropriate for any human being. But my question would be, if you knew your next door neighbor was playing a virtual reality game that involved predatory sexual behavior of children, you wouldn't accept the argument that, oh, it's just a virtual reality, it's not going to affect reality. Like, most of us would have the reaction of, oh my goodness, they think this is entertainment, I'm going to move away or keep my kids well away from them, kind of thing, wouldn't we? Whereas if it's a violent game, we seem to not have the same kind of concerns.
I do have the same kind of concerns. So I suppose I sort of rule myself out of that argument. I think that any kind of violent activity, whether it be only of the mind or in a virtual world, it affects us. So everything that we do as humans affects us and affects who we're becoming. So I think that any kind of immoral behavior, particularly of the, you know, fifth and sixth commandment kinds, is quite problematic.
Right.
It's an interesting take. I kind of also want to circle back to your question, Renee, about, you know, would, if, you know, philosophers or the arts weren't here, would we feel that something is lacking? And I'd say, you know, yeah, I think something would be. But would the same... could the same be said for if there was no virtual gaming? And Peter, you emphatically said that no, there's something would be lacking from your experience. Well, I, coming from the other side, would say that no, I don't think we'd be missing a thing. In fact, I'd say there'd be positive benefits for people not being trapped indoors and actually being in the world. I mean, you could actually go and help play with some, you know, play with your kids at the park or different things like that. I mean,
Slay some dragons.
That's right. Well, and that dragon could be your, that dragon could be your messy bed. Like, you could go and make that.
My point here, Cormac, is that my children in our current lockdown, my children are playing a game similar to Minecraft. It's not Minecraft, but similar to Minecraft, with some friends who are not currently able to come and visit us. And so they're engaged in a mutual activity online in a virtual world, which is a play that involves coordination and fun and silliness and all kinds of other things. And that's possible. And I would agree that virtual reality isn't necessary for humanity. Clearly, we've survived quite a long time without it, so we will manage to go without
it. Glad to have that on the record.
if it happens to disappear, we'll all cope. I have a great many friends that I would never have met or never have even looked at or had the time for had I met them in real life in a pub. Some of them are too scary. Some of them are simply not the sort of person who would look at me twice. Some of them are the sort of person I wouldn't mix with ideologically or just wouldn't cross paths with. But I've met these people in virtual realities, and we've become quite good friends over time. Some of them are people who literally can't leave the house for either mental health reasons or physical health reasons or their circumstances, they're isolated, that kind of thing. In other words, it provides an avenue through which other human elements, human activities, the kind of philosophical discussion, friendship, genuine concern, mutual activity can be conducted.
That's maybe a good point to segue into then a slightly different area of virtual reality, which is around friendship and relationships and forming connections with other people. You know, bar, I think, those, like, maybe those extreme cases where people may not be able to make physical contact with other people for various reasons. Can you actually form genuine friendships? And I'll target this question at Renee, actually. Can you form genuine human relationships without actually physically being in their presence? And I'm thinking, for example, of stories of, you know, the teenagers who meet online through chat forums and things like that, get into relationships that last the span sometimes of years, but have never actually been in the physical presence of one another, and you can yet go through the anxiety, the anguish, the torment of, you know, are they, you know, being faithful to me, or, you know, or I'm not sure they're being completely honest. How do I do the navigate all the complexities of our relationship? Can the virtual reality forum of engaging with people through relationships or romantic or not actually be a fair substitute for being physically in their presence?
I think it captures really important aspects of some of the activities that go along with good relationships and good friendships, but there's certainly something missing. I think as Catholics, we know that too. I mean, we're pretty nitty gritty when it comes down to it as Catholics. I think we're all missing we're missing the community of actually being together just with our fellow parishioners. I don't think there are some substitutes for physical presence, and I can think of some examples of this. Sometimes my husband and I, at the end of the day, are so completely exhausted, all we want to do is sit down on the couch and have a cup of tea together or a glass of wine or something like that. I can do that when there are two screens up. I know lots of people have been trying to do that, but it's just not the same. There is no substitute really for walking out of Mass on a Sunday, turning around and seeing the certain look in someone's face that, you know, like there's an online presence that we can put up there. We all know that from social media and this kind of thing, an online persona that is always going to be partial, better than nothing, but it's never going to be the fullness of actually being with a person. I think that there's just something missing from that whole experience of physically being there.
I would respond to that by saying it's true that while via the medium of virtual reality, I can carry on and keep relationships closer than I could otherwise. So for example, my siblings who live interstate, I can maintain a relationship with them at a much higher level than if I were merely writing or vaguely contacting them via email or something like that every now and then, because the personal contact is more through a video interaction than it is through just although some people might argue letters are very important. It was certainly a very important part of my courtship with my wife, so I'd have to think about that a bit more.
Oh, I agree. I think you're onto something there. I'd agree that my wife and I just finished watching North and South. I don't know if it's like an Austin type. I don't know who watched it anyway. But there's lots of letter writing and stuff. It's very romantic. And there is something, I guess, again, going back to that tangible physicality of having the person's writing style, the ink marks, you know, embedded into the physical page and kind of conveying something about their person and their time and their activity that can give, you know, something to you, which, you know, absent of, you know, Austin style, you know, novels didn't really have virtual reality and probably would have made it far less interesting. But, you know,
and you wouldn't have that horse coming in the middle of the night with the letter that you handed over and they brought it, you know, instead of the ding and the annoying message at 3 a.m.
I guess what I was leading up to is that I don't think it's just, I think the problem comes when we think of it as a substitute for human contact. That's the danger, because the taste, smell, feel, physical presence of somebody, the fact that when you're with them constantly in the scenario Renee was describing, when you come home and you're collapsing and you're at your lowest, or at least at the most exhausted, that's when you really sense the person, you really understand them. And even if, some of the strongest relationships are the ones where you can just be silent together and feel the genuine comfort in that. When all you've got is visual and audio, everything about that relationship has to be channeled through that, and it becomes almost and this is what's a concern with the teenage relationships. They can't just hang, they have to do something, perform, if you like, in the visual audio. There's a kind of they channeling everything into that, and it's in certain sense the reflective or just being element of relationship gets lost in that.
Yeah, I think that's right.
I guess it's just about getting back to appreciating our physical nature. Get out, smell the flowers, have a look at the garden, do some weeding, physically get involved. And for those that you happen to be fortunate enough to be shut up with, really appreciate the closeness of that situation. That's it for this week's podcast. If today's discussion got you thinking or arguing with your podcast device, let us know. You can subscribe at the website, thiscatholiclife.com.au, and all the usual social media, Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, Discord, etc. Don't forget to write us a review. And it's time for shout-outs. Cormac.
Well, in the vein of our conversation, following on from it, I would like to pay a special mention to all of those who would normally like to be outside, especially those playing team sports like rugby in particular. So my particular shout out today is going to the Redfield Old Boys Rugby Club. It's been a bit rough to not have the game that we love to play. So, you know, especially feeling it for all of you that are unable to get out there.
And I'd like to take the other side and say a big shout out to those people who are out there on the front line, making it possible for us to be safely at home. Because as much as we might find it difficult, I think that being out there, seeing everything that's going on in the current COVID-19 crisis, I'm thinking in particular of our health workers at the moment, but also those dealing in not only physical health, but also mental health. I just want to send a big shout out to them, because what they're doing is magnificent in many ways.
Amen. My shout out goes to those people who are introverts and are busy telling me it's a good time to be an introvert. But thank you for that. But perhaps you could like put on an online course or something and teach us some of your skills. That would be really
handy.
Very
true. Like that great old meme, you know, like, look out for your extrovert friends. We are not okay.
All right. That's all for now. And thank you for listening to This Catholic Life.